Everybody, welcome back. Again, the voice called. It's me. I'm playing The Binding of Isaac. Perhaps you've heard of this game. I don't know. That's probably like the 3,000th time I've used that joke. But that's okay, because here we are. We have Incubus. We have HP. We have good stats. We got a win. When I say we have a win, it's not that we have a guaranteed win. It's not that I'm guaranteeing you we're going to put up win 54 right here. 53? 55? I don't know. Look, I've been recording a lot of Isaac this week. Isaac's become like kind of a daily kata for me. I know you're like, well, it's daily for us as well. But normally I'm like I'm a batch guy. You know, I'm a meal prep guy. I make a big pot of Isaac on like Fridays, for example. No, this time there's been some made to order, which is nice, but it also means that I can't remember. The days are all blurring together. Is this 54 or 73 or 25 or 6-4? I don't know. We'll find out at the end. Either way, I mean, I'm sure you probably don't need me to tell you this. Incubus, 3.45 damage. Even with 12 rate of fire, we're looking at like a very, very, very good start here. Just want a little fire rate increase. And honestly, I really feel like, to give you a sense of place and purpose, context for where we are in Isaac, I feel like the last three runs in particular have all been a little bit spicy, and they've all been a little bit spicy thanks to my own misplays. You know, I think we've managed to make it work. Don't get me wrong, I think we've managed to... obviously we managed to make it work because we got the wins, but we weren't bad enough to lose, but we were bad enough that the win was in question, and I was unhappy to see it. You know what? I'll use a bomb for peace of mind here. Just to make sure we can get in there in time. I wanna cut that out. I don't take pride in winning an easy run by the skin of my teeth because I had lost a bunch of spirit hearts being a fool, you know? It's just the culmination of bad habits that, you know, what you really should try to do is break those bad habits when the times are good, because when the times are bad, you're relying on your muscle memory. It's not an easy thing. You know what I mean? You know what I mean. Anyway, there's nothing to freak out about. It's just, you know, we'll tinker. We'll tinker as time goes on here. We have a pill we do not care about in the least, for the time being. This seems like too large of a floor. Where's my item room? It appears to not exist. It has appeared to disappear. It's a little Flight of the Conchords line for you. Give me a Dagaz rune, because I want to see this map. I can't believe we got out of that one. I disbelieve that this is one floor. I think this is like six floors stitched together. But everything always seems, you're gonna think this is like a double entendre. Everything always seems bigger in the dark. I think that's just true, you know? Your backyard, when you're a kid, I don't know, might only be like, you know, 20 feet by 10 feet or something like that. It depends where you live. Honestly, the smaller your backyard, the more you probably lived in like a city or something like that, as you're like, I didn't have any backyard. I would have killed for no backyard when I was a kid. Alright, I don't know if I should have taken Aries here, or Taurus rather, but feel like it can only pay dividends long term. I'm excited for that. You know, in the daytime, when you've got your lights on and the sun's on, the sun's up, you know what I mean. I'm not much of an astronomer. you know, you can barely kick a soccer ball from one end to the other at full force, you know? It'll go flying over the fence, you gotta go into your neighbor's yard. But at night, when it's dark, it might as well be the caverns of the Marianas Trench. All sorts of jabberwocks and demogorgons could be hiding out there. You never know, dude. That's why it's not safe. Tears upgrade. Always very nice. Always very nice. 0.74 speed is admittedly a really not so good position for us to be in, but I was kind of hoping we could make the rest of this floor work for us. You know what I mean? Let's not use a bomb there. We could get blood bag. If we get blood bag, we get an HP upgrade. We get a speed upgrade. Everything's sitting pretty. It's hunky dory. Other such outdated English idioms, and we're off to the races. A single red heart would go a long way, too. A single spirit heart would go a long way. Like, the run is good. I'm looking for that thing that's gonna take us over the edge. You know what I mean? Like, if your soccer team is up 2-0, you're like, I'm pretty confident. That's where I'm sitting right now. We have a 2-0 lead at halftime. But if you go up 3-0 and there's only 18 minutes left, you're like, we got this under control. I can finally start to feel some relief. It would take a historic collapse for this to not be. And it might happen, but, you know, it's pretty unlikely. That's where we're at right now. We're looking for that heartbreaker to demoralize the game. I will say, by the way, a few episodes ago, I proposed an alliance. An alliance between European soccer viewers and Canadian hockey viewers. And it's all aimed at disrupting American sports hegemony. In particular, the NFL and Major League Baseball. I got nothing against them. They just have so much cultural reach. And I'm like, you know, if Canada and England and Germany and Spain and Italy band together, we could make hockey and soccer the global sports that they deserve to be, which they actually already are, to be fair. Really, the hockey was getting way more out of this arrangement than soccer would have. But I was surprised by how many people were like, I'll enter an alliance with you, but you gotta stop calling it soccer. And that's not gonna happen. Because I hear you. You're like, why should we change our name? Soccer is a game that is played with your feet. It's exclusively a foot-based game. It should be called football. Why do they call American football, football? Why should that become the default? They almost never use their feet. They start the game and kick it off. And then, you know, after an unsuccessful drive, they might punt, they might kick a field goal, and then they kick it again. But, you know, on probably like 85 to 90% of plays, we're talking about, that's interesting, but give me a second here. We're talking about, you know, it should really be called a handball more than anything else. That being said, and you're going to disagree, or you're going to be perhaps even upset with the way I express myself on this one. If we just called it soccer, then we got no problems. You know what I mean? We don't have to call it American football versus soccer. We can just coexist. It's like, I don't know why the heck hockey's called hockey, dude. It's just, you never hawk in the game. I mean, I guess on the bench sometimes after a hard shift you go like, but, you know, you're not, nobody knows why, you know, that's what it's called. It's just got a vague reason historically. So I'm just trying to avoid the confusion here. I would much rather one sport be called football and one sport be called soccer than one sport be called football and one sport be called American football, okay? I don't make the rules, though. At the end of the day, it pretty much just comes up to the populace. Okay, let's think about this one. No, that's actually pretty dangerous, but we're still in a great spot. You don't slow me down, right? No. So we're not going to take the other one. I'm just thinking this one through. I really want blood bag. And we do have that. We got a lot of stuff that could potentially work out to our advantage. Let's put it that way. This is one of those floors where I would like to take my time and just like slow simmer this one. Because we got like real genuine chances at maybe, like, getting this blood bag. If we get IV bag, what are you going to do, right? By the way, to put a cork in that conversation, the cross-Atlantic alliance, as far as I'm concerned, is still in play. We just have to compromise. You might be saying, well, there's field hockey and ice hockey. Why doesn't one of you change their name? I don't know, okay? I don't have a good answer for you, but do you want to argue or do you want to... I don't know. Talk. It's all made up anyway, okay? Don't get it twisted up too much. Alright, so we probably should not just be on two half hearts here. We're gonna kick this one over. Honestly, being able to afford PhD with Acid Baby is a huge swing. I don't know if we're gonna be able to get there, but there's definitely a chance. There's definitely a chance. So this blood bank has a lot of potential, value associated with it. We can get the money. The money could be luck upgrades. We can get blood bag. Blood bag would be HP plus speed, which helps out, Ares, which is also known as Taurus. We could also get enough money to get PhD, which gives us HP to play the blood bank more. Okay, well, let's not worry about that part then. So we've decided not to take Dr. Fetus, but it was a decision by accident. I'm willing to let you know it was a decision by accident. I think it is a great item, and to be honest with you, just a complete brain fart to not make the effort to pick it up. I think I was scared earlier, and then I decided, you know what? Let's wait and see, and then I realized the door was locked for me. But we got what we wanted, we just maybe would have wanted a little bit more. Hold on, I got a message in here. Hold on. All right. We can use this right away. Does it change what you get? I don't think so, but pacifier is good either way. I really want to start taking these pills. Like Acid Baby does have an advantage. If we could just get it going there. Beautiful. Great thinking. Good line of reasoning. Good. Yeah, HP and a tears downgrade within the course of 5 seconds. Yeah, it's a good idea. Acid Baby. Such a fun time. Okay, it's completely my own fault and I apologize. I mean, it's not my own. Well, I don't know. Where do you place blame? The people that made the pills in the first place or the people that take them? I don't know. Probably a little bit of both. Certainly, there is the ability for me to not have taken it in the first place and that would have nullified the concern, but... On the other hand, I didn't create this. Let's call it 49-51 in favor of me looking better than I actually am. Alright. How are things going? They're going well. I mean, honestly, like, even in spite of the fact that we just got, just got a health downgrade, this run is in an extremely great position. Like, an undeniably very, very, very strong position. And again, I don't think we've had perfect Isaac gameplay for quite some time here, which is disconcerting to me. Yet at the same time, this one is coming together in a big way. And I mean, that just seals it right there. It's pretty much under control. I almost wish that, you know, it would be an interesting addition to... And probably a series destroying addition to the Binding of Isaac in the new DLC. What if they treated it like a media coverage of an election? So that as soon as you got some momentum, they just called it. They went, you got it. We're not gonna make you play this one out. CNN predicts win 54 will indeed happen. Northern Lion is going to win re-election for the 54th consecutive term in the Binding of Isaac district. Now that I've said it, I feel like it is, we tried to roll the dice. I feel like it's insanely dumb, and I think that might be one of the reasons I like it so much. Come on, dude. I think it would take away from the game in a huge way. Because, you know, part of the fun is, like, seeing how these easy wins end up becoming unbelievable losses, you know? It happens from time to time. You never know until that electric moment where you finally beat Blue Baby. Sometimes you know a little earlier than that, I suppose. Did we go to our... We didn't go to our item room, right? Did we go to our item room? Hold on. We got Bloodbag on the last floor. We got Binky on the start of this floor. Oh, we got Book of Revelations in there. Okay, so yes, we have been to our item room. Without the map, I got no idea where I am. Not just in the game, but in life. It's like I have no context. I'm free-floating. Rather than having any kind of, like, tether to the real world, I'm a jellyfish making decisions based on what's in my immediate environment. I don't have hopes and dreams, plans, or anything along these lines. I merely have the ability to go from point A to point B and try not to get hit in the process. Which will serve you pretty well. That'll serve you pretty well. But it's not your, you're missing out on that higher order stuff. Anecdotally, what's going on in life right now? Not that much. Not that much. We're still, I mean, as you might expect, going through a little... I bet health down will be better. But Gulp is also pretty good. The reason I think that Gulp is not that good is just because in order for Gulp to be worth anything, you need to get, in my opinion at least, you need to get two good to great trinkets. If you only have one, you can just hold it. If you get two and you don't have Gulp, that's where you're going to be disappointed and you're going to be like, I wish I did take it with me. But for now, I mean, we can always walk back for it if we get the deal with the devil on this floor that allows us to use this health down to become a health up. I really respect HP more than I have for a long time. And there's another Gulp. I guess we shouldn't worry about it too much because apparently we're going to be getting Gulps coming out of our whatever. Things are kind of opening up in BC right now, but still very, very, very slowly, which is good, and I support it. But again, you know, if you're going to listen to my petty concerns, it does lead to weird situations like the grocery store being like, you can bring your own bags, but if the bags touch the counter at all, then we're going to put you in prison, which is not true. They don't have that kind of jurisdiction. They just merely sequester you in the frozen foods aisle for a couple of minutes, and then you're like, brr, this is cold, I should have worn a sweater. And they're like, yeah, think of that the next time before you try to let the bottom of your reusable bags touch the top of our countertop. But, you know, it is nice that people are taking it seriously here. Don't get me wrong. I will say, though, there are some negatives. Every business that is open has hand sanitizer outside of it. I gotta tell you, not all hand sanitizers are equal. Some places have Purell, other like, proprietary name brand hand sanitizers. I'm not a hand sanitizer snob. I know it's gonna sound like that's where this bit is going. Ron Caves 2. I'll try it. I'm not a hand sanitizer snob, sincerely. However, that stuff... I'm out. I'm not even going back for Gulp. That stuff does the trick, you know? It smells like alcohol. You feel it drying out on your hands. Probably destroying your skin cells, but also, you know, any virus and bacteria particles. That's okay. Some places... You know, local, like, Vancouver breweries have been, or distilleries have changed their factories in order to be able to produce hand sanitizer instead of producing, whiskey or gin or whatever. And some of those are pretty good as well. You know, you use it and you're like, this is a solid hand sanitizer. Doesn't leave residue. My hands aren't sticky. We went to one place last night, Kate used the hand sanitizer, and she was like, don't use it, it's just vinegar. And it really was just a bottle of vinegar. I will say, given the choice between sanitizing with vinegar and sanitizing with nothing, I guess I would choose the vinegar. However, I would like to read perhaps one study on whether or not vinegar diluted is capable of actually doing anything in that role. You know what I mean? Because otherwise, and I like pickled foods. I love them. But I don't really want to smell like a dill pickle. I don't want to smell like brine. If it's got to be done, it's got to be done. But there's definitely gradations, you know? If I see that Purell, I'm like, this place is, it's bougie. If I see a nondescript bottle with a label maker that says hand sanitizer on it, I'm like, I'll give it a try, but I'll admit I'm skeptical. By the way, can we talk about this tinted rock? It was a double tinted rock. I spent 2 bombs, blew it up, got a golden chest. Inside of the golden chest was 5 cents. Are you winning, son? No, Dad. I'm not. Highly unrecommended. But you know, that's the deal. That's where we're at today. I left the house yesterday with the mask on. Anybody else, I hope you're wearing your mask out there. If you're not, I hope you got a good reason, not merely a podcast-based anecdote from somebody who's not a scientist. But either way, anybody else get like a fake persecution syndrome when you wear a mask? I've read all these stories online from people. Ooh, we're gonna at least take it. That are like, whenever I wear my mask, I get funny looks. And then I had one insane person yell at me and say, take off your mask. Bill Gates is trying to force you to get vaccinated. Wake up, sheeple. And in my head, I'm like, oh, man. That's what's going to happen to me when I'm outside. So yesterday, I was wearing my mask outside, and I noticed some people, like, looking at me and laughing. Not openly, like, ha-ha-ha, but, like, you know, chuckling to themselves. And I was like, wonder what's going on there. What, you think you're cool just because you're not wearing a mask? Oh, wow, my immune system is so strong. It's so strong I don't even believe in science. And then we got into the grocery store. Kate was like, oh, your mask is upside down. And I realized they weren't laughing at me because of the mask in general. They were laughing at me because I'm a grown man. Soon to have a family, of a full-time job, responsibilities, and yet, you know, couldn't even get the text on the mask to face in the right direction. And then I felt like I was the fool. That's pretty much all we got. That's my anecdote. I wore a piece of clothing upside down. And I've been trying to play some Mahjong. But I'm still extremely bad at it. I'm more mad at it as well. Because the first couple of games that I played on the Switch, I actually won. It was against the AI, but I won. And I was like, yo, this game seems pretty fun. And then in the like 3 hours I've played since then, have not even come close to winning against human beings or the same difficulty of AI. It's like I ruined myself with my beginner's luck. I set the bar too high, and now I can't go back. It's the danger of accidentally doing well at something the first time. It's like at the start of a video game, you know, when they're like, they give you all of your powers. It's a classic video game trope. They give you all your powers at the start, and you're like, whoa, this is crazy. And then, like, an evil wizard comes in and is like, I'm gonna sap you of your power, and all of a sudden, you're like, I can't even double jump anymore? That's where I had my power sucked out by the Mahjong Monstars. I don't know if the world's ready for a 32-year-old man. I'm not 32 yet, I'm baking this in for the future. But a 32-year-old man playing The Binding of Isaac for 3,500 hours, and also talking Mahjong strategy. We're not ready for that yet. But your kids are gonna love it. I think that's the line from Back to the Future, right? Zodiac? I think I'm gonna say no to Zodiac. Now, if you had Exodia, then we'd be talking. Is Exodia... So, admittedly, I am a nerd, but I'm not a nerd about everything, you know? A lot of the nerd stuff that people talk about, I have to pretend to understand in order to stay relevant to my audience. So, I can't make a Yu-Gi-Oh! Joke. I was always more of a magic kid growing up, right? Is Exodia the one that's like, you get the card that's like, the left arm of the Exalted One? The right eyeball of the Exalted One. Is that Exodia? Or is Exodia merely a single card? I don't know. I don't have an answer for you. I'm hoping you have an answer for me, and then I'll look in the comments and be like, okay, now I've learned something. Butter? A plain plate of noodles with a little bit of butter? No thank you. I don't know, like, conversationally, this is a weird one for me, because I feel like I have not had an Isaac episode this calm in a long time. Everything is like pretty much completely set up to win relatively easily. It's super nice. I'm having a great time. I might as well take it. We might not get another deal with the devil. Betrayal's not worth too much, but it's worth more than zero. I found pills. Yeah, well, Joni loves Chachi. Does Chachi give a flying frick about Joni? Is that from Dodgeball? Here's a question for you. I really feel like, and I felt like this for a long time. So I apologize if this offends you. And I want to say, first, there's been, I don't know if you guys keep up with Zoomer culture. I don't know if you're on the talk. I'm on the talk, not bragging, but we had a 850,000 view clip come up on the talk this week. Just saying. But if you're on the talk and you follow Zoomer culture to stay relevant, Adam Sandler is having a bit of a moment. Adam Sandler is, he's got good press right now. And I don't think, you know, it's not because of Uncut Gems or anything like that. It's because, you know, people who were, I don't know, like 7 when a movie that they liked came out with Adam Sandler are now like, you know, 20 and they're like, I like this guy, he makes me laugh. Which, to be fair, if you want to be snobby about it, is exactly how a lot of my generation feels about Adam Sandler. They're going, you know, oh, Happy Gilmore is great. I don't like the other stuff that much recently, but, you know, Happy Gilmore, it will always have a place in my heart. So I think, you know, we're all the same in that regard. But I've always thought of Adam Sandler, or of Ben Stiller, as the thinking man's Adam Sandler. You agree with me on that one? He's got a, you know, a similar kind of vibe. He's made some transcendent comedies. He's acted in more serious roles and has been involved in the production behind the scenes as well. But has also made some incredibly, incredibly dumb movies. Like, Zoolander is one of the dumbest movies ever made. I do want to say I saw it in theaters, and I still like it. I think Zoolander is a hoot. It is a laugh a minute. Let's not say comedy classic, but, you know, it's kind of, it's close. I hesitate to ordain every single 7 out of 10 comedy from my early teenage years as a comedy classic. I would really say that, you know, there's only a few comedy classics that have come out over the course of my lifespan, like under 20. Hangover 1 I do think counts, even though I would love to put on my bougie hat and be like, that's quite prosaic, but I suppose it did tickle a chuckle out of me. The death of Stalin has got to be up there. Maybe like the Big Lebowski. Depends how you consider like Fargo. I wouldn't consider Fargo a comedy, though it has some funny moments. Anyway, like we don't need to go down this list. I was unprepared for this. Rushmore. I would definitely say that Rushmore is it. Okay, well, apparently we are going to go down the list. I forgot what else I was. What was I talking about? Oh yeah, but Ben Stiller, I've always considered him kind of like the thinking man's Adam Sandler. A little bit less silly, a little bit more consistent, but still occasionally makes can either make you laugh and regret it, or can make you laugh and appreciate it. What's your favorite Ben Stiller movie? Let's say, what's your favorite Ben Stiller comedy? Because I like to separate it, because it's the same, like, when you ask people what their favorite Adam Sandler movie is, I want to separate it, because I know that you've been trained to be like, the right answer is Uncut Gems, or Punch Drunk Love, or maybe Rain Over Me. I want to know what's your favorite, because Uncut Gems is probably my favorite Adam Sandler movie as well, actually. But I want to know what your favorite dumb Adam Sandler movie is. For me, it's Happy Gilmore, for sure. I think it's the best of all of them. What's your favorite Ben Stiller movie that's not The Secret Life of Walter Mitty, or The Royal Tenenbaums, or the Meyerowitz stories? For me, I think the easy answer is Tropic Thunder. I remember when Tropic Thunder was coming out, I was like, this is probably going to be bad. First off, it's got Robert Downey Jr. in it. And I mean, like, what has that guy done lately? I mean, sure, he was Iron Man, but that's just a one-off thing, right? This was back in the day before the MCU was even a glint. Well, it was a glint, but it wasn't quite a glimmer yet. Let me all have you know, it wasn't yet a glimmer. We're going to hold this health up for now. And then Jack Black. And I don't know, like, I have always really liked Jack Black, but he admittedly... I mean, I think Jack Black is hilarious. Genuinely, maybe, like, the most naturally comedic and like, joy-inspiring personality in Hollywood that I can think of. I don't know if there's anybody that I've ever met that is like, I don't like that guy. But that being said, he's been in a lot of garbage. Especially 10 years ago. But it's been garbage. Every piece of garbage that Jack Black has been in has been elevated by Jack Black, not the other way around, right? And then Ben Stiller is like, you know, fresh off Night at the Museum, which as a 20-year-old guy, I was like, he lost his touch. He hasn't been the same since the dodgeball money hit. But I don't know. I think Tropic Thunder's got to be number one. When I started hearing that it was good from, like, critics and audiences, I was like, I don't believe you. Then I went and saw it, and I was like, no, this is actually hilarious. Fair enough. You did good. You did great on this one. It's a great movie. We will obviously take some of this, but we're pretty much in the clear. Dare I say, by the way, I'm actually happy I didn't take Dr. Fetus. I'm happy we sat on it. I think that we ended up having a better run as a result. By the way, oh my god. I was literally just about to say... I don't think we want to take this health down, even though we could have made two health ups. Takes a lot to create a situation where you're disappointed with a health upgrade. But, I mean, I'm only slightly disappointed. It's okay. I mean, you know what? We are one guppy item away. I mean, we should try to let this one ride, I think. That's helpful. That's not. Relax a little. There you go. I mean, I'm genuinely thinking about it now. I'm like, anybody out there dislike Jack Black? There are probably people that are like, I don't care for him. I don't care for him is different than like, oh, if you see him in a movie, you're like, I'm never going to watch that. Plus, don't get me wrong. I know School of Rock is well-liked. I've never seen it, but I know it's very well-liked. And I've seen Bernie, Jack Black's darkly comic turn as a funeral home owner slash mortician who is involved in the disappearance of his abusive and wealthy wife. Great movie. Very, very fun movie. I know it doesn't sound like it would be fun. It's a fun time. A laugh a minute. Okay, stop walking onto the spikes, please. I think he's a great actor. I just think, like, especially early in his career, he didn't have that much to work with, you know. Orange County, Year One, ooh. And he's delightful in Jumanji, I wouldn't disagree. I really, like, I will watch any video that is shown to me that has Jack Black in it. Like, I like other comedians. Like, I like Steve Coogan, who's also in Tropic Thunder, for the record. But if you link me to, like, a 10-minute supercut of Steve Coogan on late-night shows and panel shows, I would probably be like, eh, you know. Maybe I'll watch it later. If you link me to a 10-minute supercut of Jack Black, his best moments on, like, you know, Jimmy Fallon, I would be like, I'm gonna watch that immediately. It's must-see television. I don't know, I find him, I just find him delightful. I really do. Just a genuinely, naturally, extraordinarily funny man. And that's my speech. That's my speech on Jack Black. The Merriam-Webster's Dictionary defines jubilation as a sensation of extreme happiness or comic levity. And those are the words that I would use to describe America's sweetheart, Jack Black, star of such films as Jumanji, Welcome to the Jungle, and Jumanji 2, The Next Level, and also Goosebumps 1. And I don't know if he was in Goosebumps 2. I think in Goosebumps 2, that was kind of like Goosebumps 1 merely did okay enough to greenlight a sequel, but not okay enough to double down on the budget from the first one. I think maybe that was kind of like more of a value play for the studio. I can't remember. No. I got nothing else to say. You want anything? Just tell me. I mean, it's supposed to be a two-way conversation. I asked what your favorite Ben Stiller movie is. I'm just saying, if you say, okay, here's Dodgeball, acceptable. I disagree, but acceptable. Heavyweights, sure, I'll allow it. Zoolander 1, all right, fine, I'll allow it. Night at the Museum, look, I wasn't there. That wasn't part of my moment as a human being. That was part of the generation that were people, you know, maybe like 5 to 10 years younger than me at the time. I understand, though. That's okay. If you say Zoolander 2, get out. Get out. Go see. That's the only movie you've ever seen in your life, and I don't respect it. I won't enable it. I won't enable it. Yeah, I know. It's got the original cat. I don't know where I'm going. Let me out of here. That was a good win, though. We are at 54 wins now. Great stuff. For now, thanks for watching. Hope you guys have enjoyed it. If you did, click the like button. It helps out a great deal. Of course, subscribe if you want to see more in the future. Thanks for your support. Please do click the like button if you enjoyed the episode. We're 38 minutes and 13 seconds in. That's worth a like if you enjoyed the content, and I'll see you next time. See ya!